Do not adjust your digital device. What you are about to see and hear may shock and appall you. Join our hosts as they encounter countless thrills, spills, chills, and hilarity as they explore the very weirdest in pop culture. The following media is so strange, so beyond the scope of what is normal, it will make you ask the question, why does this exist?
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Why Does This Exist? I'm Chris.
And I'm Rob.
And today we will be talking about the death metal band Deceased. To start off the spooky season of Halloween, everyone. And oh, what a glorious Hallows Eve it will be.
Yeah.
But if you don't know the show, we are Why Does This Exist? We talk about weird stuff in pop culture, whether it's a movie, TV show, video game, or musical act, or anything in between, like trading card games. We discuss all of those things and more, and that's about it. If you want to support us, like, financially, that will be really nice. All of the links are at the bottom of the episodes and everything. And that's all we got to say about that. It is 10:30 on a Sunday night. I've had several cigars. I've played poker and gambled my life savings away. I'm loaded up on whiskey and my pants are off. So I think we're in for a really fun time. Which means you are now about to witness the true strength of street knowledge from a ragtag group of rogues. So let's get on with the goddamn show. Rob, take it away.
All right. So Deceased, as you had said before, is a death metal slash thrash metal band from the fine state of Virginia. Predominantly, the only real member that's been consistent throughout its entire history is King Fally, of course. They started the band back in 1984, and their goal was to out-thrash Slayer, which I think they probably did. So they started in 84, but the first album, Luck of the Corpse, did not come out until 1991. They had a number of demos before that, but like I said, their first album didn't come out until 91.
They were the first band ever signed to Relapse Records,
yes.
Which is the coolest thing that nobody else can say.
Yeah. And for those who don't know, Relapse is an independent record label from Upper Darby Township, Pennsylvania. And they mostly have grindcore, death metal, metalcore, and sludge bands.
The band that is probably most associated with Relapse Records is Death.
Yes.
Which, funny enough, another term that people used for Deceased. So it's just Death and Deceased.
Yes. Death and destruction for everybody.
Yay!
Just listening to Deceased a little bit before we, leading up to doing the show, I noticed something, and I've noticed this before in other forms of music. I think the best example is like punk rock. Punk rock originally started in the U.S. with bands like the Ramones and New York Dolls and that. And eventually made its way across the Atlantic to England, where you had the Sex Pistols, the Clash, and that. And then, going off of that, came back to America, and you had hardcore punk, which, in my opinion, was kind of like the Americans' answer to British punk rock. Because British punk rock was a little bit more raw, a little bit, like, more nasty with lyrics, a little bit kind of, like, more hardcore than the original like American punk bands were. And so when it came back across the across the sea to America, you know, we kind of, our answer was hardcore punk, which, you know, so, and that kind of, that trend kind of continues throughout all of music history and different genres. The heavy metal had the same thing where, you know, it started in England, came to America, and, you know, America kind of did its own thing for a little bit. And then you have the new wave of British heavy metal, which inspired the thrash metal bands. And, you know, thrash metal kind of went over back to Europe, and you had bands like Creator and Destruction that were like thrash, but that was like kind of like really the birth of death thrash. And I think that Deceased is really the answer to that. They really feel to me like they're like the America's answer to Creator, you know?
Yeah, I would have to agree.
It's just like so much more heavy than a lot of the other thrash bands at the time, and really has the, you know, the death metal vocals and that kind of like death metal like feeling to it, but also still has like the thrash roots and is a little bit more melodic than like traditional death metal like Cannibal Corpse or anything like that.
Yeah, I mean, the thing that I enjoy the most is that is not even just those two things. The interesting thing about them is that a lot of their songs are longer. Like, a lot of their songs are, like, 6 to 7 minutes.
Yeah.
And they keep your interest the entire way. And, like, it takes really interesting turns. And a lot of that is because of the Voivod influence, because there's a lot of experimental stuff going on. And there's a lot of, like, they really play with the ambience. And they play with the they play with the atmosphere so that it, like, because everything has, you know, I mean, if you can't guess from the band name, everything had, like, involves the macabre and the morbid and the weird. And the music really takes that direction in terms of, like, the melody and throwing in, like, all the weird changes and the dissonant chords that you'll hear out of Voivod stuff.
Yeah.
And it starts to feel a little bit less like left field, but it also creates the atmosphere of the music. So, like,
yeah,
this is a band that is like, it is fully aware of the vision, and it really strives to achieve that vision with every piece of music that they make.
Yeah.
And it gives you that good foreboding feeling, like, I mean, pretty much anything off of, like, I mean, if you look at anything from, I would say, 95 to 2000, or I would say that's, like, this is the core of what, of, like, the Deceased albums, like, the big three that you should listen to, that like, if you just want to, like, introduce yourself to Deceased, the three that you want to get into are The Blueprints for Madness, Fearless Undead Machines, and Supernatural Addiction. And that's really, like, where you will hear the most, like, that's like, if I were to introduce somebody to Deceased, I would tell them to listen to Fearless Undead Machines.
Yeah,
just listen to that one album. And like, but yeah, but those three, Blueprints for Madness, Fearless Undead Machine, and Supernatural Addiction, I think are, like, the quintessential, like, if you could just, like, if you're just trying to, like, get someone into Deceased, this is the way to go. And as the Weird, Travel On, and Surreal Overdose are also, like, very, very good.
Yeah.
They also don't have a bad album.
Yeah. Well, and when I was, it's funny that you mentioned it, because I, when I was listening to, like, you know, get myself acquainted a little bit more with Deceased before we did the podcast, I started with Blueprints for Madness.
Yeah.
And, so, you know, I, it really was like, you're like right about that. It's like really, you know, a good thing to start with, to learn what, like, Deceased is. So yeah, I also thought it's interesting that starting out, and for most of their history, King Fally actually played drums and was on vocals,
which
it's crazy for a death metal band because of like the like how intense the drumming can be, you know. That he did that.
Yeah, that was like, well, that was the thing that really set them apart from everything, is because, I mean, first of all, it's rare enough that you see a singing drummer, let alone a singing drummer for death metal.
Yeah.
Like he had stepped into the foray, I want to say somewhere in the 2000s, he had like stepped into like the foray of being like just the frontman, I think, because
yeah, early 2000s.
I think it had to do with, I think part of it had to do with like some health issues.
Yeah.
Where like he couldn't really do, or like he wasn't really able to do both. And like,
I mean, it's amazing that he was able to do both at all for the kind of drumming that he was doing, you know?
I can't imagine the stamina that he must have needed to play that.
It's crazy. The double bass while singing and, you know, and scream, not like just singing, but like, you know, death growl lyrics, you know, the amount of like lung capacity King Fowley must have had was like probably obscene.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, but he's just so cool. Like if you've never seen Deceased, try to see them as soon as you can. They play, if you're on the East Coast, they play pretty regularly. And I think they also do like visit Germany like pretty often, and like European countries.
They've been at Maryland Death Fest also, right?
Yeah, they've played it. I think they've played MDF a few times.
Yeah.
And I mean, because they're from Virginia, so it's like very close by a lot of the East Coast.
Yeah.
They play New York fairly often. I remember like the year that I got into Deceased, I think like maybe the first 2 years that I saw them, that I had been getting into them, I think I saw them like 5 or 6 times.
Yeah.
And like, well, there were some shows that interviewed
King Fowley.
Yes, I have. I interviewed King Fowley. And I was going to share this story a little bit later on, but I'll just do it now since we're on the subject. But like, when I was in college, I interviewed King Fowley for this publication called Review Fix that I was writing for, that is created by a college professor of mine, Patrick Hickey Jr. And he and I interviewed King Fowley because I had met him a bunch of times, because just from like seeing him at shows and like just playing. Actually, wait, did you go to the Morbid Saint show?
The one that was at Europa?
Yeah.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, then you saw Deceased.
Oh, okay.
They opened there. Yeah, so you've seen them too.
Yeah, so I have seen Deceased then. Yes. I just didn't remember because it was so long ago.
Yeah, it was a very long time ago. But yeah.
That was a fun night.
It was a great night. That's where I remember our good friend Greg.
They had like a coffee. It was, I don't know if it was a coffee table. It looked like a barrel, but had like a glass top, and somebody broke it.
Oh, I did.
Oh, you did.
Yeah, because they started like, because it's like a nightclub.
Yeah.
And like, it occasionally had metal shows. And so like, and for some stupid reason, they didn't move all their tables around or whatever, or like they didn't get rid of the nice tables. And like, people started moshing. And like, I just remember I don't even know if I was even moshing, but like, I was either moshing or I was like within like a certain range of the pit, and like somebody like flew into me, and like I flew back, and I expected to like, and I got taken off balance, and I expected to hit the ground, and it never happened. And I just felt this like, cushion under my ass. And I'm just like, and like I stood up, and I was like, oh, something broke my fall. And I turned around, and there's like a broken like fancy glass table with like an ass groove in it. And I'm like, oh, that was all right. I did that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I broke a table that show. That was fun. And then Morbid Saint was great, and Deceased were great.
Yeah, that was a fun show.
Yeah,
Unfortunately, does Europa even exist anymore? Or is it like, I remember there was like, they were really pushing to do mostly like DJs there and stuff and not actually any kind of bands or metal or rock bands anymore. It was all like DJ dance party shit.
Yeah, they went back and forth on that stuff a bunch of times. And like, they also were across the street from a police station, which didn't help. And yeah. I think there was an incident where like, I don't know if there was an incident between like a metal guy and like a club bro guy, or if it was just like club people, but like there would always be problems with that club because they were in proximity of like, they were like, if you cross the street, there's a precinct right there. So they probably just like, I mean, the cops if they were low on their quota, it was probably great for them because they could just wait outside and just like pick up the drunk assholes. And just like, you know, put him in and write him up.
Yeah.
But I think there were like several incidents with just people getting into like fist fights outside, and I think they had to shut it down. Yeah. Or they like had to like update codes or things. They were like, yeah. that place always had problems.
I remember like, cause like the metal, like the stage that we saw Morbid Saint and Deceased on was upstairs, and they had like a club downstairs too. And I just remember coming out after the show and all these like fucking like, you know, like preppy fucking people and people like in nightclub clothes were like staring at us like, oh my God, like what the fuck are these people? Like, yeah. You know, got all these like metalheads coming down the stairs and stuff. And yeah, it's weird because there's a lot of same shit where like they'll have a show and then as soon as the show's over, they like bring in DJs and they're having like a fucking like nightclub party. And
I feel like a lot of places did that or do that to like make ends meet. I mean, I don't know how often it still happens. I don't really go. Yeah. And there's so many venues that have closed down now after like COVID and just
that's
time.
I was going to say is like COVID killed off like so much of New York's nightlife. I don't even know if that still happens anymore with the DJs shit. I mean, I'm sure it still does.
You'd have to ask the possibly now you'd have to ask the now disgraced mayor, because like his whole half of the reasons why like this guy, I mean, whatever this guy got indicted on, it seems like it was like all the stuff that he got indicted on, it seemed like it's probably stuff that every politician does, but he was just dumb enough to get caught.
Yeah,
like he tended to draw a lot of attention to himself. Like he would be posting like photos to it, he would be posting stuff to his Instagram about him like at like nightclubs on like, you know, Fridays and Saturday nights at like 2 a.m. and like, you know, him partying with celebrities and stuff. And people are just like, oh, so this is what you're doing with our tax dollars. Great.
Yeah.
So like, just dumb. Do not broadcast that to the world if you're a public figure.
Like, yeah.
Like, let me I want to assume that you are in your mansion thinking about things to do for the good of the people and not out popping bottles.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately that's like our politicians nowadays.
It's like, if it was like, they're pretty much not hiding that. It's just a show and they don't care about you.
Yeah, it's fucking wrestling. It's pro wrestling.
It is pro wrestling. Anyway, so the story it was a very fun time, but I mean, this was like, what was it like 2011 maybe?
Yeah, it had to be like 2011 or because it was.
Yeah,
I barely remember it.
It's got to be somewhere between 2009 and
it was definitely after 2009.
So maybe somewhere between 2010 and 2013.
You and I didn't start hanging out until like early 2010.
Okay, so it probably it was probably 2011 or 2011 it was probably 2011 or 2012 then.
Yeah. We met up at it was a creator show, wasn't it? In Gramercy or something.
Yeah, it was creator and Voivod.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. So that was like early 2010, like January or February. Yeah. And then we went to the Megadeth show out in Scranton.
Oh, that was the following month.
Yeah, that was great.
That was one of my favorite shows.
Yeah, and then
because like, was the whole time, the whole like experience was great.
Yeah, it was a fun day. And then the Morbid Saint and Deceased show. I feel like that was in the winter time though.
It was
like early spring. Yeah. Maybe it was like late 2010.
Yeah, it had to have been either late 2010 or early 2011.
Yeah. And I remember there was
I think it was late 2010 though, because I have a feeling it was in November.
Yeah, it was like probably November or like late October, because it was chilly out, I remember.
So you know what? That might have been the second time that I saw Deceased, because I had seen them earlier. I had seen them like a month or two before that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, man. I remember that year, actually, between 2010 and 2012, I think I saw. I think I was, on average, I was seeing like two or three shows a week.
Yeah, I was. 2010 for me,
very steady period.
I was going to at least one show a month, I know for sure, for like all of 2010.
Like between 2010 and 2013, just that string.
Yeah, but I was like between like, you know, going to shows in the city plus like the little shows that we had at the Meat Locker. I saw a couple shows at the Meat Locker, and like, you know, there was the Megadeth and Slayer at Testament, Megadeth and Slayer at the Izod Center. That was a really good show.
Yeah, that was. Oh, that was the one where I got lucky and like I had the free ticket.
Yeah, that was the one. I got so sick the day after that. I don't know what it was, but like I drove home. I stayed at my grandmother's house after the show in Karlstadt, and I drove home the next day. And when I got home, I literally was I called in sick to work. I was like deathly ill, like with like stomach issues, like vomiting, everything. Oh. For like every like 20 minutes. I don't know what, if I ate, me and Roberto went to like Wendy's before the show, so I think that's what did it.
That wouldn't surprise me. Maybe Beavis and Butthead were flipping your burgers.
Yeah, it could be. But yeah, that was bad. That was a really fun show, though. It was just a great year for shows. That whole summer, like, I saw Exodus, like, probably, like, three or four times that summer, at least. Yeah. Saw Testament a couple of times. We saw Megadeth twice, because I saw them.
Yeah.
The original tour was the Testament, Slayer, and Megadeth tour, but then Tom Araya had to have back surgery. He threw his back out.
That's right.
And so they delayed that tour to the summer, and they ended up with the Megadeth, Exodus, and Testament show, which was fucking awesome, because that was like the Rest in Peace tour. And then also, and I think Testament played all of something.
They played the first album, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think all the Legacy, I think.
Yeah. Right? It was the Legacy.
Yeah.
And then I think they did it again later on. And then also year, I think it was also that year where Anthrax did Among the Living in its entirety.
I don't think I went
the year after. I went to the New York one for that.
Anthrax on 420, but I think that might have been in the next year, like 2011 or 2012.
Yeah.
Because I remember there was a dude like smoking weed on the street, like while I was waiting in line, and like there was, and this was, you know, way before weed was legal in either New York or New Jersey. And I remember there's a dude smoking a joint, and like there was like two cops standing there, and they just didn't even give a shit. Like it was like so like chill. It was like the most random thing ever. But that was a cool show.
Well, because on 420, nobody gave a shit. But also, like, I mean, I don't know if this was true, because I never. Like went to Central Park or like any of like the any of the parks on 420, but like I had heard that if you went to like certain parks, people or cops would just like, they would just leave, they would just drop like just dime bags, and or like if you wanted to smoke, you could like go into those parks.
Really?
And like you could just smoke weed in those parks on 420, and no one would arrest you if you were inside the park.
And it wasn't like entrapment.
Well, no, but once you left the park, if you had anything on you or you were smoking anything, then they could like, you know, then they could give you a summons or whatever it was.
Yeah, yeah.
Like it was kind of like a catch 22.
Yeah.
But I don't know how true that was. So I can't speak to whether or not that was a real thing, But if you know, then like, you know, just like if you know, you know, and you know, if you got an experience with that, let us know in the comments or something. But yeah, just a weird time. But that was the best. Yeah. Also, there were so many more venues where like now,
yeah,
now even though like a lot of those venues still exist, like Live Nation has like screwed everybody so much with like the whole Ticketmaster monopoly. Yeah, we're like all these tour and like Live Nation screws all of these bands over to such a degree where like only the big bands are really the ones that are going to be working with them. Yep. And like all the smaller bands don't mm-hmm. want to like the smaller to mid-sized bands don't want to work with them at all. So that's why you never see shows at those venues.
Yeah. I saw that
pushed out to all of these venues that are in the outskirts of, you know, like Brooklyn and stuff where it's like a pain in the ass to get to.
Yeah. I saw that coming back in those days, like in the early 2010s, like as I was going to shows more and more, you were seeing like venues that were being bought by Live Nation, and like it would all of a sudden like the show would be like, oh, presented by Live Nation, or like, you know, Gramercy Theater, like presented by Live Nation or some shit. And it was like they were like slowly buying up all the venues in New York City.
Yeah.
And it was really just so they could friggin' own and monopolize everything.
No, you know, I remember you called it and you were like, yeah, they have to stop this.
Yeah, because it was like, you know, back in those days, yeah, you could buy tickets online through Ticketmaster, but they would charge you an arm and a leg for all the friggin' processing fees. So people would just go right to the venue and you could buy them day of at the venue or even before that, and you could get them for way cheaper.
Yeah, and I mean, that's what I would do too, and I would make a day out of it. Like, we would make plans specifically to go, like, okay, we're going to meet up here. Then we'll buy the tickets because they open at this time, mm-hmm. and then we'll go to this part of the city and hang out and we'll do whatever.
Yeah.
Like, it was fun. I miss doing that.
Yeah. And you could even, like, there was a time where you could actually buy like tickets to shows at like, they had like box offices at like the mall and shit like that. You could go and buy tickets.
Oh, I didn't know about that.
Yeah. But then, you know, I think Live Nation started to see they were losing so much money because they couldn't charge people. Well, and this is really before Ticketmaster and Live Nation combined. They were still kind of two separate entities.
Yeah.
But then, like, once they combined, it was all over, and that was it. Like, because they at that point, they were the only option. Like, they, because they own the venues and they own the fucking tickets. And so there was no way to, like, get around them anymore.
Yeah. You were screwed.
Yeah. And it killed live music in New York City, as far as I'm concerned.
I mean, it's still killing it. This is why, this is why, like, almost nothing is ever sold out anymore, because everything is so jacked up, and that's, one, inflation, and two, these assholes just buying everything up.
Yeah.
Where, like, and, like, chart, and, like, price gouging everything, where you're like, okay, well, I wanted to go to these three shows because the bills are great, but they're all, like, way too expensive, so I have to pick one.
I remember,
and it sucks worse for the bands because one, they're playing to not the size of the crowd that they deserve, and two, they're also like which means that they're losing out on merch, they're losing out on ticket sales, so now it's that much harder for them to make money, and they're already getting squeezed anyway by like the music industry as a whole because nobody makes money from their music anymore.
Yeah,
because of
Spotify
and like all of these like archaic laws that don't distribute the rights money properly and like doesn't pay anything out, and those laws have not been updated since like half a century.
Like 20 years. It was like 20 to 30 years ago is when they, like, in the night when the internet really first started to, like, you know, like around the Napster days and shit like that, that's when they updated the laws, but they haven't updated them since then.
I didn't even know that they updated them once.
The Digital Millennium Copyright Act is what caused like all of like, you know, it's like what they use on YouTube when they do a DMCA takedown. Like if you put something that's like copyright, even if it's a fair use, they don't even check because it's like an automated system that uses an algorithm. So like you don't actually have a human looking to see if it's something that's fair use. Like if it's a parody.
That I hate. That's bullshit.
Yeah. So That DMCA is what caused that, which is the Digital Millennium Copyright Act. And that was like at, you know, around like the early 2000s. But like,
no, I'm talking about like royalty payments and like how that's distributed and allocated.
Right. Well, that's like the last time anything like that was ever like enacted, though. Like there hasn't really been an update since the early 2000s, even though the technology is like miles and miles ahead of what it used to be.
Right. No, but I'm talking about like what bands actually earn from.
Right. No, I know like, what you're saying, but I'm just like, that's why it's like, you know, it's, you know, archaic, the laws, because it's been that long since they've been updated. Like, they need to be updated again, is what I'm saying, so bands can actually make money, but it's not going to happen because it's like lowest priority possible for anybody. Like it doesn't, like, nobody cares if the music industry dies, because like they don't see it as like a legitimate, like, you know, industry, even though it's like, you know, imagine a world without art and music, it'd be horrible. So like people take for granted, you know, that whole thing.
Yeah. It's sad. But anyway, we're getting off topic, but, the story that I wanted to tell about, deceased was like, I interviewed King Fowley like many, 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 many moons ago. I'm not even sure if he even remembers that this interview even happened. But this was maybe, I want to say it was like around that time, 2010, 2011. That's how we got here.
Yeah.
And I was dorming at SUNY Oswego. I did an interview with him for the site Review Fix. And, you know, lovely guy. I've met him a few times after seeing him so many times. He always took time to just sit there and talk to you and just rage on. And like, he wouldn't go to a dressing room. He would just like maybe, you know, he would maybe just like get a towel to like just dry off of it because he sweats a lot. And he would just, you know, he would just hang out with the, like, he would just like hang out with you, get a beer, like just like shoot the shit. And then like, he would like, you know, just kind of grab onto you and like be into that head and do like that big like headbanging circle with you. And he would start the mosh pits and everything. Like, he's great.
Yeah.
He's an awesome guy. Wonderful human being. Nicest guy you'll ever meet. He is very salty on his takes of a lot of new music, and he's very critical of that. So he's like, he can be like one of those guys where it's like, oh, everything new that this band puts out is like, is terrible. And like, and you can't change my opinion. Only the best stuff, only the old stuff is the only good stuff. And it's like, okay, that's fine. But like, great guy to shoot the shit with. Really, really, really good person. And a killer musician. Anyway, we do the interview. Nice guy. We have a good time and everything. I wouldn't be surprised if I still have his phone number saved somewhere. But he, like, and I was telling my buddy, my friend Kenny about it. And I was, and like, they were playing in Pennsylvania, like maybe a month or two after that interview. This was like a few months after that. And I was like, and I told my friend Kenny about them, and I was like, and he got into it, and he was like, oh man, they're really like, I really like this band. They're really cool. And like, we, you know, and we were like, okay, yeah, we could drive down to Pennsylvania and go see this show. Like, we could go to this metal show here. And we go, and we were going to go down to Philly, and I think Condition Critical and a few other people were playing too.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, it was Condition, maybe it was Condition Critical. Anvil Bitch was also playing, and I wanted to see them. Which to this day, they have pretty much evaded me, because the one other time that I could have seen them, something, which Deceased also played this show, was something happened, like one of the bands dropped and they moved the show a half hour. They moved it back a half hour. And as I walked in, Anvil Bitch was playing their last song. So I saw the last song because they moved everything up. And then Deceased went on, and I was like, okay, cool. But still like, ah, curses He-Man.
Mm-hmm.
And we were going to go to the show. We're all ready to go. It's the day of the show. We were going to drive down from SUNY Oswego about 3 hours, right? And we were, and my friend's skateboarding, Kenny's skateboarding. He's trying to do like this, he's trying to like do this big gap. He does it, but he lands in a way where he rolls his ankle in like, and it like starts swelling up immediately. And he really is just like, I can't walk. I ruined the day. I'm so sorry. And he's sitting there in the nurse's office and he's feeling so like bad. He's feeling so guilty for himself. And he's like, I really wanted to see deceased. They sounded so cool. I'm sorry. I didn't want to let you down, man. I'm so sorry. And he's like really bummed about it. So I called King Fowley. And yeah. I said, hey, we did an interview, like, hi, I don't know if you remember me. We met a bunch of times in Brooklyn, I've seen you guys a bunch of times. We did an interview a few weeks ago for Review Fix and everything. Could you do me a favor? Okay, what's the favor? Like, is everything okay? And I'm like, well, I'm in upstate New York. I'm at school. I was going to... me and my friend, we were going to come down and see you in Philly tonight. But so we were going to drive like maybe three, four hours down there to go see you guys. And my friend was skateboarding and he messed up his ankle. His stuff's all messed up. He's on crutches for the day. He can't really drive down. And so we're not going to be able to make it. And he's like blaming himself and he feels really, really bad. Would you mind just getting on the phone and cheering him up? Like, and he was like, oh yeah, absolutely. Like, yeah, put him on. And I was like, dude, thank you. This is the nicest, coolest thing that I really appreciate it. So I go up to Kenny and he's like he's still a little sulky, and I'm just like, hey, someone wants to talk to you. And he's like, what? And so he's like on the phone, he's talking to him for like a good 5-10 minutes, and he's just like, and he's like, holy shit. And like, you know, you could see his spirit lift, and he's like really, he's like super happy, and like it made his day. And I was just like, thank you so much for doing this, man. I really appreciate it. I will never, like, I hope I see deceased again, just because I'm like, that's one of my fondest memories, just because it was just one of the nicest things anybody could do. And like, he didn't have to do that. He could have just been like, no, like lose my name and my number. Like, you fucking weirdo, never call me again. Yeah. But instead, like, he gave like a bit of himself just to cheer somebody up. It was really, really kind of him.
Class act.
Yeah, absolute class act. You know?
Yeah.
But yeah, deceased. I love how their stuff changes on a dime, and I love how they fill that horror ambient. Like, and a lot of the writing, like, I mean, he's like a big horror movie buff.
Yeah.
There's a lot of samples that they'll use from obscure horror movies, and they'll throw it in, and it'll like really fit in. And they won't just use it in the beginning as an intro. They'll weave it in to the music itself, and it'll create so much more of that tension that they're trying to get.
Mm-hmm.
And honestly, I love it. My favorite is Fearless Undead Machines, which is, pretty much I think, and as far as I'm concerned, it feels like a love letter to the original Night of the Living Dead.
Yeah.
Which it pretty much just is a love letter to all zombie movies. But it's the other thing is they do they do concept albums too. That's another thing with Deceased. Like, I think Fearless Undead Machines, and I think Blueprints for Madness might also be a concept album. They have a few concept albums in their repertoire.
Yeah.
But they're just so cool. And you don't see concept albums very often from death metal bands.
No.
You could probably count on one hand how many death metal bands have even done it. The only one that really comes to mind now is Exhumed.
Mm-hmm.
did it. Or Death Revenge.
Yeah.
But there's really not many many death metal bands that have concept albums.
Yeah. There's thrash bands that have done it, but you don't really see it often with death metal.
Yeah, and also Deceased Live is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Like King Fowley he's with his stage presence and everything, people have like dubbed him the Michelin Man of death metal because of like the way that he like runs around. It's really great.
Yeah.
But yeah, what a great freaking band. Like,
yeah,
their music takes interesting twists and turns. There's a lot of influences coming at you all at once.
Mm-hmm.
Also King Fowley has also founded and ran several of his own record labels.
Yeah.
To help like a lot of like old school bands, to help with like re-releases, and also like to like fuel a lot of deceased releases and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
I think he told me, and I mean, forgive me if this is not true, but I think that they still were on good terms with Relapse, and when they split from them, or they're at least on better terms now. And it was just one of those things where he just wanted to do his own thing, and he wanted to run his own labels and all this other stuff, and like there were things that he was hoping to get that like he just didn't see, so he wanted to try to like, you know, strut off and do it. And you know, that's just the way that it goes sometimes, but he's always tried to give back as much as he can.
Mm-hmm.
And like they've really just been very much still like a DIY kind of band, and they still have that fighting spirit. Like, I mean, the mainstay has been King Fowley, but there, you know, and there have been like various tragedies and deceased, like their original, like they've gone through hardship, like they've had members pass away and stuff like that. But they also, you know, there's still like a lot of things like that they've been going on throughout the years, but like they do also still do a lot of cool things. And also it's hard when like, I would say like, they're not as successful as like other bigger bands that, and I think they should be a lot bigger and like more like financially successful than they are. I like success is always in the eye of the beholder. That's why I said financially successful. I think they should be one of those bands that's making, you know, millions. But just, you know, there's only going to be a handful of bands that are able to, and that's whether, and it depends on what machine's going to get behind you really.
Yeah.
But pound for pound in terms of like musical talent and ability, they're in the 1%. Like they're so freaking good.
Yeah.
And they've inspired so many people, but also like the whole giving back thing of just being kind,
mm-hmm.
like that goes a long way into like forging all the friendships and connections. Because who knows how many tours they would not have been able to set to like to do if they didn't have the reputation of being good people.
Yeah, well, I think that's important in like the indie music scene is the camaraderie, and that was something that was always kind of present when we played too. You know, you make friends with like the people in the scene, because it's like you're all in this together. You know, there's like a brotherhood there, you know.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And I mean, the sad part about that sometimes is like, you know, you don't see people for a long time when you kind of get out of it, or like you don't.
Yeah.
Or like life just kind of happens for a lot of people. And, you know, whether like. And just sometimes you just don't have time to make new music and be on the road and play shows and stuff like that, because like other life's other responsibilities kind of get in the way of that stuff.
Yeah.
And it sucks when you don't see people for long periods of time, and then you go back to a shows, and then like everything changes when you go back to like a local scene just to see what it was. But sometimes you run into those people again, and it's as if it's like you saw them yesterday.
Yeah.
You know, like some of them are still in bands. I went to Lucky 13s maybe like a year and change ago, and just saw some of our friends that were still playing in bands from those days, like Steve Pro and Devin.
Yeah.
Like saw them, and it was just freaking great to see them and just like hang out and just catch up. But it was like nothing happened.
I'll be actually going awesome. Later on this week, I'll be going to see Condition Critical and Nervosa down at
Condition Critical is playing that show too with Lich King?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's Condition Critical, Nervosa, and I'm pretty sure that's the tour. Hold on. I'm just going to look it up just before I put my foot in my mouth here.
Yeah, I may be going to the one in the city. It's not in the city. It's in like Bushwick, which I cannot stand that it's that far, but
Condition Critical is not on this.
Okay.
You know why I thought Condition Critical is because Mike is in Lich King. Yeah. So that's why I was like, Yeah. But, well, Mike will be there too, so that'll be cool to see him. Yeah. It's been a while since I've seen any of those guys. And,
I feel like the last time I saw him was when I also saw Sam the last time that Lich King came around, and like we just got very drunk.
Yeah.
It's
a thing bath on Thursday, so I'm going to that show.
Okay, I may or may not go to the Friday show. I don't know whether or not I'm going up to see my parents this weekend, because it's my mom's birthday on Monday, and we're doing something for her on Saturday.
Yeah.
So I don't know yet what I'm doing.
Then Birdman, he's having a free birthday show on the 18th up near me in Middletown, New York. So
Cool.
Go to that too.
Huh.
I'm interested in that. So
I gotta get back in touch with that guy. I haven't talked to him in a long time.
Yeah, it should be a pretty good show. His band is playing, and then Rob's band Dystopica is playing, and then also the Donner Party and Shadow Witch.
Oh, I didn't know the Donner Party was still around.
Yeah, apparently they are. So
wow,
should be a good show. Not far away, which is awesome.
Nice. But yeah,
I mean, I've been trying to get to more shows again, because you know it was I took such a long hiatus from going to shows just because like real life got in the way, you know. And it's like, well, I want to like see shit, you know. Like life is too short to not go to metal shows, you know.
Yeah, and I agree. Like my wife is always saying stuff like that. She's always like, you know, you really need to get out of the house. You should just go. Like, or if I'm like, oh man, there's like a metal show here, but it's too far. I'll be like, oh, so and so invited me to a show. I don't know if I'm gonna go. She's just like, you need to start going to these things.
Yeah. Well, you know what the problem?
Like, it's just good for you.
I've always been myself, kind of like a homebody. I liked staying home, but COVID really like made that a thing. You know, I didn't go anywhere during COVID. And so it's like, you have to kind of like get back into the mentality of going out again and enjoying life again outside. So,
yeah. Yeah, I agree. Just to bring it back around over to Decease, just they're one of those bands that comes around often enough where like it's weird. They're like, they're different. And we're like, a lot of bands, when they come around, like, often enough, after a while, you kind of get overexposed to them, and you don't really want to see them for a little bit, and you kind of want to take a break. But, like, you could see Deceased, like, every week for, like, months on end, which I kind of did. I saw them, like, 4 or 5 times within a 6-month period.
Yeah.
They came around so much, and every time it was like I was so excited and happy to see them. And they also always changed this set up around, even though it was like a month or two later.
Mm-hmm.
It was like, you could have played the exact same set, but you move things around. And like, you know, if you talk to him about it, you like King Felu would just be like, yeah, we have like 20 something releases with different songs on them. So why am I going to play exactly the same thing? There's so many good songs.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's also like good to see that like they still have, I mean, they've always had that passion for everything where like they just want to keep doing different things.
Yeah.
But yeah, I love this band. It was also the, I think the first time that I ever heard of them, our pal Dan Barlickham, when I was in Raging Steel Obliterator and something like, you know,
Mind Jumper.
every band name under the sun.
Yeah.
Basically. They're Dan's favorite band and band.
Oh, really?
And I think he picked me up from the train one day, and we were going over to Joe's or we were going to get lunch or whatever the hell it was.
Mm-hmm.
And like, and he had them on, and I was like, who is this? And he was like, you don't know Deceased? And I was like, no, I don't know Deceased. He's like, oh, they're the best band ever. These are the albums you should listen to. I can't believe you'd never heard of them. I'm like, I'm so sorry. And he's like, well, they are the best band, and they're my favorite band, and they're the greatest death metal band that ever existed, and fuck you if you think it was anybody else. And I was like, I don't know, for some reason, like, Dan is like, he reminds me of Lance Storm, the way that he speaks. And, but like, great guy. I have not talked to him. I haven't talked to them since then, so I haven't talked to him in like 15 years. But
yeah,
really awesome dude. I need to find out how to get back in touch with him, because I'm trying. I don't bother with like social media or anything.
Yeah.
But I still know people that know him, so I need to find a way to get in touch with him.
Yeah.
But yeah, shout out to Dan.
Yeah.
as some people refer to him, the motherfucker who looks like Keanu Reeves.
Yeah, it's true. It is true.
I hope that you're doing well, sir. And if you stumble upon this, well, bully for you, sir. But yeah, he introduced me to them, and it was just like, and then like one day I was just looking for shows to go to, and I was like, oh crap, these guys are playing. I should go. And I was very happy. But yeah, really, really awesome, fun band. Like, just, I can't say enough good things about them. So just buy every single thing of theirs. Like, that's my advice to you. Buy every single thing that Deceased has released.
All right.
And go see them whenever they can.
Yeah.
Oh, also, King Fowley has a book that he put out in 2017 called Stay Ugly, The Life and Near Deaths of King Fowley. It's an autobiography. I believe it had a low print run, so it might be a little tougher to get a hold of it. But
yeah.
If you can find it, like, go ahead and read it. I've been trying to track it down for quite a few years because I didn't get the original printing. So yeah. I will have to find a way to dig it up and just make that one of my, I guess it could be. Well, I'll try to find it in time for the holidays. And just buy it for myself and just throw it under the tree and just say, oh, look what you got me, honey. And look, she'll be like, yeah, that's what it's going to be. It's going to be, look what Santa brought me. I'll try to throw a lump of coal in there just for authenticity. I don't know. King Fowley would probably appreciate it better if I said Krampus got it for me.
Krampus, yeah.
But, like, I don't know if I should put, like, well, I mean, if I'm gonna say it's Krampus, then I need to commit to this thing. I'll just put, like, a toe in there instead of Cole.
Just have like a. Someone dress up as Krampus, take you, put you in a sack and beat you with reeds, and then give you the book after you're.
Oh my god, down by the river. Down by the river. Oh, that's all. All right. I think that's all I've got to say about that. But Deceased is friggin' awesome. Fearless Undead Machines is one of my favorite albums. And I just remember like when I was ramping up to like to get ready for this show, and I was listening to Deceased, and like it had been years since I had listened to them, and I was like, and I was listening to them, and I was just like, I sat there. And I was in the middle of like whatever. I was in the middle of like doing whatever I was doing for work. And like, I may have been at a coffee. I think I was in a coffee shop. And like, I just stopped what I was doing. And I sat there and I took my, and like, I just like, I stopped what I was doing. And I just sat there for a second. And I was just like, I just said out, I don't know who heard me, but I said it out loud, pretty loud. And I just said, wow. I fucking love this band. And I don't know if I've ever done that before. But yeah, that's all that I got to say about Deceased. I love these guys and I'm like super super happy. Also, he is in the band October 31, so check them out too. Check them out too. Right. It's a very similar band, but it's just like more straightforward, old school heavy metal. But yeah, they're really cool. All right, now I'm really done. All right. Well, thank you everybody for checking out the show. We really appreciate each and every one of you. We hope you had a good time, and we hope you enjoy your October. And we hope you enjoy music, and we hope you've learned something, and like go check out Deceased, and we hope that you are find another, just another cool way to enjoy life and all of its trinkets.
And as always, we have more spooky stuff to come later on in the month, so watch out for that.
Yes, we do. All right. Well, this has been Why Does This Exist? I have been Chris,
and I've been Rob.
And remember, question everything.
Good night, everybody.